I'm Radhika Das and you are with me on the Daily Dispatch. Today's top stories are from GlobalBees, Zetwork and Paytm. Platform for D2C brand growth, that is GlobalBees, has acquired two more new age companies. One is a fashion jewelry brand, Yellow Giants, and the second is a home care brand, Absorbia. Now both the teams of these brands will become a part of GlobalBees. With this acquisition, GlobalBees aims to give the brands a strong presence in their segments. Reports suggest that Zetwork Manufacturing is bringing together a $250 million funding round. It is expected to be led by US-based Iconic Capital and Green Oaks. Now, the funds are likely to be used for global expansion plans, which include inorganic growth opportunities. This funding round is likely to be closed by the end of this month. Ahead of its IPO, fintech giant Paytm has raised 8,235 crore rupees from anchor investors. The subscription opens from November 8 to 10. A few investors who participated are GIC of Singapore, CPPIB of Canada, BlackRock, Abu Dhabi Investment Authority, among others. Paytm will become the fourth Indian startup to hit the public markets after Zomato, Nykaa and Freshworks.
All right, joining us today on this very power-packed panel is a host of experts from the hospitality and travel space. Joining me on this conversation is Mayank Bhatt from Social, Deep Banka from Zostel, and Siddharth Gupta from Tribo. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for joining us today on the Daily Dispatch. I want to begin by talking to you about the hospitality industry. It's seen its worst in the pandemic. I think every single hotel owner or person in the hospitality space has been affected by the pandemic. Wanted to understand, are things looking better now with things opening up, people traveling and people making travel plans for the latter half of this year? Or what kind of experience have you seen? I want to begin with you, Siddharth and Deep.
Thanks, Priya. No, absolutely. I think we've seen a pretty sharp recovery in demand over the last 4 to 5 months, but particularly so in the last 45 days or so. I think it's evident that the great vaccination numbers that we are seeing has helped remove some of the fear psychosis that people had around the third wave, travel not being safe, etc. And indeed, we are seeing a sharp uptick in people's willingness to travel. We've seen almost a 10x jump in the last 5 months and a literally a 50% month-on-month jump this month in our numbers. I think people are stepping out. It's still predominantly leisure-driven, but we've also seen a big reopening of corporate travel. So I think, fingers crossed, that this continues for the times to come as well.
Very similar to what Siddharth said, the trend I believe has been universal across the country, although it remains destination specific to some certain segments. For example, leisure has seen a better recovery as compared to corporate travel. As of now, we at Zostel are doing 90% recovery with regards to leisure travel, and almost 70 to 75% recovery with regards to corporate travel. So we are seeing good progress in the past 3 months, and I think the trend has been gradual. It has been steady since the past 6 months now. Almost like beginning of this financial year, trends have been upticking in all aspects. So looks good. Looks nice in the future.
Right, Mayank. The eating out space is also seeing a lot of takers. Restaurants are going full forward. Reservations are happening. Good times for the restaurant industry.
Yeah, we're finally smiling a little bit. Compared to the first wave, the second wave recovery has been sort of very, very quick. So it took us close to 3 to 4 months after the first wave to come back to 70% of pre-COVID numbers. But it has taken us barely like 6 to 8 weeks to come back to 80% of pre-COVID. So it's in the right trajectory. We're still facing curfews in some of the key markets. Post 10 p.m. Some of them are like Bombay has gone now to midnight. So we're just waiting for, while we get into the season, we're just waiting for the licensing and the curfews to relax a little more.
Right. You know, I want to bring all three of you in on expansion, because that's one thing that the hospitality as well as the restaurant industry has been looking at this point in time, considering that eating out is coming back in a big way. I want to understand from you in terms of what kind of expansion plans do you have as of now? Is it back on track? Because we've seen 2019, 2020 see a little bit of pause as far as overall expansion is concerned. So let's begin with you, Deep.
Very correct when you say that the expansion plans were paused in the past 1.5 years pandemic time, but as of now we are back on track. We are back on track on what we were envisioning the tracks to be. As a basic idea of business, Azin's Hostel has never been about numbers, as in going deep into the number game. Our history very well showcases that. We are currently 50 destinations. 55 destinations across India and Nepal. So our challenge has always been to be organic, mobilize the community, and to make use of that. So we are right back on track on what our actual path is. So hopefully, and when things opening up, people being able to travel, the team being able to travel, the stigma being attached to it going away. So I think the business development will continue now in the same sense.
So what kind of expansion plan do you have at Zostel in the next couple of months at the end of FY22? How many new locations are you opening up? Are you expanding capacity?
In the pipeline in the next coming quarter, we have about 12 locations in the pipeline for hostels, whereas just a year before pandemic, we started with the concept of Zostel Home. This is basically moving into an alternate accommodation segment. So that alternate accommodation segment also has about 15 new properties coming up. So net total of 20 properties, which we can see in the coming quarter to 4 months. Sort of.
Right. So still on an expansion overdrive. Siddharth, what's happening at Tribo?
We are super hungry for supply. We are going after properties now quite aggressively. We have consciously held back all this while. But that's changing now. And every month, we are adding about 35 to 40 properties to our current portfolio of about 500 that we have. We obviously need to be mindful of preserving the quality standards and the brand standards as we do this. So it's not about signing up a lot of properties in the same locations, rather also widening the location base at which we are present. So we actually also hired a fair number of people in our business development team so that we can go after it in a wide manner rather than a deep manner alone. And that's kind of helping. So over the next 3 months, we'll probably increase our portfolio size to more like about 650 to 700 properties.
What's the plan? We've seen a lot of people go and sort of pull down shutters for a lot of restaurants out there, because it was really not sustainable considering the kind of lockdowns that were happening. So I believe even social did some rationalization for properties that weren't working out and all of that. But what is it looking like at this point in time? Expansion on the horizon?
Sure. Yeah, of course. I mean, can't stop opening more stores. We lost a few in the first wave. For sure, because I mean, it was new for all of us, for us, our landlords, and everybody else in the business environment. So we had to strategically close down a few, but we opened 5 more in the pandemic, and we have 6 more coming this financial year till this March, and about 12 to 15 more for the next financial year. So I mean, we are looking at key micro markets. New markets like Hyderabad and Calcutta for sure, and then key micro markets and hyperlocal areas in the metros that we are in. So yeah, I mean, expansion is going to be key.
Right, expansion is going to be key. I want to talk a little bit about the kind of way prices have moved. While in the hotels industry, I want to talk about like the tariffs in terms of what kind of movement we've been seeing, because it clearly looks like because of the kind of demand increase, tariffs have really gone very high. A lot of them have even hit the roof for a lot of segments, specifically the popular holiday vacation locations and all of those. So, while we're looking at budget accommodation, even budget accommodation is expensive for students, for people, working professionals. I want to begin with you, Siddharth, at Tribo. Which way have tariffs moved have we seen a visible increase in tariffs pre-pandemic and at this point in time?
See, Priya, tariffs currently are highly polarized, I would say, right? And it totally follows the demand pattern. So I would say in general, tariffs have not risen up dramatically. If you just look at the averages, they are, I would say, still somewhat subdued compared to pre-pandemic. But yes, if you are looking to book hotels over any of the long weekends, for example, you have to be prepared to shell out a fair bit, right? So for example, this month on the Dasera weekend, our prices were indeed quite high. We were doing, you know, all our leisure destinations were nearly at 100% occupancies, some increased overbookings, etc. So the prices in these destinations on these dates will be very high, no doubt. Certainly very similar to the peak periods pre-pandemic, right? So that's kind of full recovery, even better than that now. But if you see the regular weekday prices in, let's say, the regular business cities or tier two cities, those are still, I would say, quite regular and a notch below the pre-pandemic level still.
Right. Deep, what kind of tariffs are we seeing as hostel?
Well, the trend has been dynamic, extremely dynamic in the past 7 months, let's say, since things started to get better. And when I say dynamic, it has been that the demand trend has also been constantly changing. The demand trend initially was from a long stay orientation or less than average duration of stay of 7 days, 6 days, 7 days. And now it has like transitioned on to back to what the demand trend was like pre-pandemic level. It seems to be moving towards that. So the prices have also fallen suit, followed the same pattern, the same path. Long stays, of course, because it's for a longer duration, you tend to lower down the prices and give a better deal to your customers. But then again, coming back to how things are looking right now, we are back to the same prices as we were doing at pre-pandemic level. And in fact, an interesting thing that we did just relaunching the properties post-pandemic was the fact that we priced it higher. We had to cut down on a lot of inventory. We had to cut down on a lot of, we had to increase a lot of standards. We had to increase a lot of cleanliness, maintenance, COVID-related protocols had to be incorporated within our policies, within our SOPs. And that probably led to an increase in a 25% sort of an increase in the price structure then. But post that, it has been pretty much constant. Looking ahead, it seems to be going up as it was pre-pandemic.
Right, but as you mentioned, long duration stays, the pricing is slightly less. But are people even opting for long duration stays now that remote working is sort of out of picture? A lot of people are returning back to work. So have we seen a reduction in long duration stays?
Well, reduction, yes. Is there a complete masking of long duration? No. But yes, there's a definite reduction that we have seen in the past 6 months with regards to long.
Right. Mayanka, what about average order value? How is that moving? Are you seeing an increase out there?
Yeah, we have definitely seen an increase in the AOVs. Also, what we've seen basically is people moving to premiumization. The second lockdown opened up and after the first one opened up too, what you saw is the amount of time people are spending at an outlet had increased. So you saw an increased amount of time because if earlier you were stepping out 6 to 8 times a month post the first wave or the second wave because of safety issues, you were only stepping out 2 to 3 times a month. So basically, we sort of saw a trend of sort of a little bit of revenge buying. But I think that is now sort of flattened and the AV has definitely increased along with it.
Right. Now, I want to talk about focus areas for the business going forward. And I want to begin with you, Siddharth, to understand what would be the key focus areas for Tribo now in this coming financial year. Now that we've seen the pandemic really play out, numbers are looking better now. So at Tribo, what do you think would be your top 3 focus areas going forward?
Yeah, it's quite clear for us. There's one thing which is always a constant for our business, which continues irrespective of pandemic, no pandemic, which is our focus on guest service and quality of our hotels. That continues. And that is important because a lot of these assets are reopening after a long time. There's been a hiatus in the demand. So it's likely that there may be a lot of maintenance work involved, a reinforcement of quality standards, before they kind of go full throttle on serving our guests. So that is a constant for us at all points in time. Coming out of the pandemic, the one thing that is extremely important and very clear as a target for us is to break even, achieve profitability. And we are seeing a great opportunity to do that. And obviously that will go hand in hand with expansion because our margin equation is now pretty clear. And we just need to add more supply and grow our top line to be able to break even at an EBITDA level. So these two things will go hand in hand. And we do believe that by in the next 9 to 12 months, we should be able to break even at an EBITDA level as a result of the massive growth that we are expecting, which I spoke about earlier.
Right. You know, the festive season is just around the corner. We're seeing New Year's, lots of travel plans happening in the New Year's period as well. Deep, what is your focus area going to be and what kind of demand can we expect, you know, going forward?
In the industry that we operate in, the hospitality industry, quality absolutely remains to be the paramount importance. Of paramount importance, so this is the customer experience. So of course that is one area that is always a constant, that is always a baseline that we can always take up, that we can always elevate, and that we can always improve on. So that absolutely remains to be a key here. However, we are looking to automate that. We are looking to build on that through tech. We are looking to get in more vision, deep insight on that through tech and products. Let's see how much we are able to do in, with regards to that. Alternatively, with regards to the supply also, we are going ahead and launching a full-fledged supply campaign, wherein we'll be opening our arms or inviting a lot of other partners who are already running businesses, who are not running businesses, new entrepreneurs who wants to move into hospitality as a business. And then let's see how we are going to take them all together and increase the supply.
Interesting insight out there. Mayank, good times for the restaurant industry. End of the year, best time for lots of people to go out, eat, enjoy. Yeah. What will the focus areas be?
Absolutely. I mean, dining remains number one focus for our business. While this entire pandemic has put focus on delivery industry, earlier delivery used to be 5% of our market share, now it is about 20% and stabilized at that. So the focus will also still remain on delivery to basically maintain that while dining grows. Also, I mean, some efficiency depends on. So we're looking to sort of capitalize on that and sort of now make it a norm and make it a standard practice, whether it is sort of effectiveness rentals, whether it is working with a new sort of talent model and recalibrating the entire store with the number of people working in the store and stuff like that. So yeah, like these two are key, focusing in on dining and stabilizing delivery.
All right. On that note, gentlemen, thank you very much for being a part of this very interesting panel. It's been a pleasure speaking to all of you and we wish you all the very best in your journey forward. Thank you very much for being a part of the Daily Dispatch.
That's a wrap for today. On behalf of my team, wishing you a very happy Diwali. We'll see you on Monday. Mm-hmm.